God has given us tonight to be back into His house. I want to ask you to be much in prayer for this coming Wednesday night for our Awana program that is beginning. I want you to tell everyone that has any children all the way up through the sixth grade about being here for the Awana program. That is an opportunity children have to be able to learn the Word of God. I know there's a lot of teachers we're going to be praying for that's going to be involved in our Wednesday night and our Wednesday night Awana program. So please remember that in prayer. As you pray, let's pray that God will also bless them and just meet every need. And then they'll be beginning at 6:45. So please remember that on Wednesday night. And then we'll have our regular prayer meeting time here in the sanctuary at 7 o'clock. We just want to give God praise for all that God is doing. If you'll take your Bibles tonight and turn to John chapter number 4. Tonight as we continue, I want to continue where we were this morning and how God is working our lives and the opportunities God has given us to be part of, I believe, living in the greatest time on earth. And we are living in a time of sheer chaos in some instance, if you want to look at it that way. But what an opportunity for you and I as a believer, because I want to tell you what, Jesus still has the answer, amen? And He still is the answer, so we want to praise God for what God is doing and just thank Him for being so good to us. I want to give just a little bit. Y'all hear me now, can't you? Praise the Lord. I want to talk a little bit as we get into John chapter number 4. How many of you know that 8 out of 10 people in our community is not in church and is not saved? 8 out of 10 people. How many of you have seen at least 10 people today somewhere besides church? 8 out of those 10 are not in church or not believers. I want to tell you, that brings an opportunity for you and I. Because guess what? Everybody needs who? Jesus. Everybody needs Jesus. Now think about that and think about the statistics that are going on around our world today of people. There's more to me in church life, to me listening to Christian radio, having Christian stations on the internet, having all these gospel programs that are going on all over the airways on TV. It looks like there will be more people on earth today that are believers than ever before. It looks like to me, with every opportunity that people have, that every single church that there is in America would be looking on where are we going to put the people. Amen? Can I just let you know something? That is not how it's working. Did you know there is a lot of banks in America? Did y'all know that? But that does not make every single person in America rich. Y'all get it? When you think about our lives, just because there's a church in a community, it does not mean that that whole community goes to church. Now, when I think about what we have talked about for about 4 years now on Sunday nights is about church growth. What's the church here for? Why do we exist? How are we made up? How is our missions? How are we supposed to react into the whole cause of the gospel going to the world? All those things that we have looked at over these past about 4 years, bringing us to this place where we are now, and listen to how God is speaking to us about where we are, what we can do. I want to tell you, we are not a church, and we should not be a Christian that is waiting for the next 4 months, waiting for that harvest time to harvest people. And I hope this morning that God open your eyes and open our eyes as a church out of where we're supposed to be. Before I left the parking lot, someone sent me a message that had not that was not here today. They were watching on the internet. They were watching live, they sent me a message with tears and said, "I just want to let you know what God did for me today. God restored my purpose. God helped me to see that where I am and what I can do right where I am." How many of you know sometimes in our life we feel stuck? You ever feel stuck? You ever feel like, wow, I'm just here and just kind of going through the motions? Well, I want to tell you, God, sometimes when you are stuck, He has got you stuck where you are so that you can bloom and be a believer right where you are, be that light right where you are, so that those that see you going through that mud and see you going through that place where you are stuck, they can understand that, yes, God is able, and I can trust this God to bring me through where I am. And so when I think about that, there's a little book that I used to have. I'm one of these people that loan out books, and I never ever remember who I loaned them to, and so I will never see them again until they're on the shelf in heaven. But I used to have this little book. It was by Ralph Sexton Sr. It was simply called Bloom Where You Are Planted. And so when I think about that and think about what Jesus is doing for these disciples, you got to remember something about these disciples and the ministry of Jesus. They did not just stay in one place. They're moving through the whole region of Galilee. So they're going from town to town. They're going to take the gospel message. Yes, they did have homes. Yes, they did have places that they returned to. They have places where they stayed. Peter was down in Capernaum, and he had a house there. And so that's where his wife and mother-in-law lived. And so when his mother-in-law moved in, he just started following Jesus everywhere. But when you, y'all get that one of these days. But when you think about these men, what did they do? They established who they were and who they were following right where they were. And you know, as a believer, as Christians today, God wants to use us right where we are. I'll be real honest with you. I got saved whenever I was 17. When I was 18 years old, I mean, God had absolutely filled my life and set me on fire, and God had given me direction and spiritual desire, and I was like just overflowing and watching God and wanting to see God move and work. I remember a Christian person one time told me something that was a kind of like a stab. I didn't understand this till a little bit later, but really what they were trying to do was trying to keep me from talking about Jesus every single sentence and everything that I did at work, and they were trying to tone that down. Y'all know what I mean? Okay. I didn't really see that at the time, but I did understand as I sat across this guy's desk. He said, man, you know something, here you are, you know, you're saved and you've been raised here all your life and all that, but you're really going to have to move like out of town somewhere else, go to another town for God to use you. Now, I was a young believer. Even though I've been in church all my life, I was a young believer, because being in church does not make you saved. Amen. I said this at a funeral the other day. If being in church will make you saved, every janitor that cleans the church will be saved. Just walking in the building don't change you. It's Him that changes you. Amen. But I remember that statement. It stabbed me in the heart. I thought, man, here I am. I'm willing, Lord, to go wherever You want me to go, to do whatever You want me to do. But now here's somebody that's supposed to be saved and they're supposed to be spiritual and all this, and they're telling me, hey, but you can't be used right where you are. Now, let's give you a good analogy, or a good, however you want to say it, of that statement that guy gave me that day. Nah, that ain't it. God wants to use you right where you are. I know that the Bible says, where Jesus said, a prophet is without honor in his own country. And I understand what he was talking about there is they watched him grow and they say, hey, this can't be him, because he was born. I watched him grow up. I seen all. He really can't be the Son of God. This can't really be the God-man that has been sent. But whenever they saw what he did, then they wanted to crucify him, because they understood, wow, this is him. Amen. But when you look at our world and you look where the disciples are in this story in John chapter number 4, they are doing, as we said this morning, what they always do, but something happens in their hearts. Something has got to change in our life. Something has to happen in us as a church, as believers, for us to be able to change. I want to tell you something about church. We can buy every program there is, and we can say, hey, you know, this is what we need to do to make our life. This is what we need to do to make being a witness easier. This is what we need to do to make discipleship better. This is a plan we need to follow for this to happen. And I want to tell you what, unless God changes our heart, we will never change. And so what Jesus is doing with the disciples in John chapter number 4 is He is giving them what they need so their life can change, so that they can become the person that Jesus saved them to be. You got to understand something about these disciples. They are messed up people. These disciples are not people that had everything in line and everything in order, and Jesus said, come follow me, and they said, yes, sir, and they knew every single thing they needed to do. No, they're just like me. They learned. They had messed up. Look at somebody and say, you just all messed up. We all messed up. Thank God Jesus loves messes. Amen. And that, can I just look at somebody else and say, Jesus loves your messy self. Amen. He loves messes. He took all these disciples. You look at Peter. Wow, Peter was one. He steps out. He follows Jesus. He's one of the ones that pick up his cross. And he would have the biggest cross, if you could have got it in that day, the biggest cross to say, I'm following Jesus. Yet you watch him fall and you watch the things happen in his life. These are men that are learning. And so what Jesus is doing in John chapter number 4, he is taking them from the place they have been focusing right here. All they can see is the disciples and the little things that they are doing. They cannot see this here. They see themselves as the ones that are going to reach the Jews. They see themselves as the one who are going to keep the church going. They don't understand that God is using them as the catalyst to take the gospel around the whole entire world. Wow. What if today we would understand that what we do as a believer is so important that it can affect somebody all the way around the world? It does, by the way. And here we are in this story in John chapter number 4. And we're going to read again verse number 35 and then come down to the rest of these verses. Look at verse number 35. Jesus says, say not ye, there are yet 4 months, and then cometh harvest. So Jesus, first of all, he's taking their mindset away from what they think is going to happen. He said, behold, I say unto you, lift up your eyes and look on the fields, for they are white already to harvest. And he that reapeth receiveth wages, and gathereth fruit unto life eternal, that both he that soweth and he that reapeth may rejoice together. And herein is that saying true. He said, one soweth and another does what? Reapeth. And then he said in verse number 38, I sent you to reap that whereon you bestow no labor. Other men labored, and ye entered into their labors. And he says in verse number 39, he said, and many of the Samaritans of that city believed on him for the saying of the woman, which testifieth, he told me all that ever I did. So when the Samaritans were coming to him, they besought him that he would tarry with them, and he abode there. How many days? 2 days. And the Bible goes on to say, and many believed when they heard his word. This evening for just a few minutes, and we've been talking about, they did this morning, about the harvest is ready, about understanding that where we are right now is the time to do what we need to do. Can I just let you in on a little something about us as Christians? We are good at being Christians at church. Would y'all agree with that? We do a pretty good about being a Christian at church. We know when to pray. We know when to bow our head. We know when to give the offering or bow our head when the offering plate comes by. Y'all know? We do good at those type things. But what about our working or our labor or our reaching into our field? There's something that happens whenever we understand that there's people that we need to reach, and there's people we get very uncomfortable. I know I don't need to have any amens right here. I'm just speaking because I know where you are, because we do this. Right? Y'all. I'm going to ask, anybody ever get uncomfortable when it comes to talking to somebody that don't know Jesus? Like, hey, what am I going to say? What if I don't have the answer to the question they asked me? Right? Anybody ever been there before? Sure. I've been there. I stay there. I mean, every time I get ready, I think, okay, if these people are going to ask me something I don't know, what am I going to tell them? I'm going to tell them, you need Jesus. They say, yeah, but what about so-and-so in the Bible and what happened? You need Jesus. You get saved, that's Jesus. What it is. Amen. There are answers. When you look at where we are at the place that God has got to open our eyes after the harvest. And help us to understand as we read these scriptures and as we look, number one, how we saw this morning that they were, he was sent from God. We need to understand today, God has saved us. God has left us where we are. It is 2017. It is a chaotic world that has absolutely no idea where to go or what to do. It is a world that is grasping for straws, looking for somebody to have some kind of answer. Jesus goes through Samaritan to give one woman the answer she was looking for her life. Can I tell you, that person that is sitting in the cubicle beside of you, or working on the machine beside of you, or sitting in the desk beside of you at school, you have been sent to where they are. You got to think about, God has put an eternal seal upon your soul if you are a believer. And God, you are His ambassador. And everywhere you go, you are representing who Christ is. Realize we are sent. And I am sent in the name of Jesus, for the cause of Jesus, to the place Jesus wants me to be, so that I can be a light to that person who is living in darkness. Jesus said in Matthew chapter number 5, verse number 14, ye are the light of the world. You're like a city that's sitting on a hill. They're watching you in the good and in the bad. They're watching you in every decision you make. They're watching you in the choices that you are making in your life. You are sent for that time and for that person. Second thing, we looked at it this morning, not only are we sent, but also as we think about it, he said, say not. He said, look, don't just go about life as usual. Understand, we have a God. I love Ephesians chapter 3, verse number 20. That He is able to do exceeding abundantly above all I can ask or even think. You ever thought, well, God, I sure would like to say you to save my whole workplace. God's idea of saving your workplace is saving your workplace and all the families that go with your workplace. He's bigger, amen? Say not. Then we look at that last this morning about seeing, about God opening our eyes, about lifting up our eyes, looking and understanding everywhere we go that God has placed us where He is, where we are, because there is a harvest that is ready. That word that he uses in verse number 35 means that it is ready to die. That if somebody does not reach out and get it today, that it's not going to happen. That opportunity is going to pass. We understand as believers, and I hope we do, and I realize that there's times in our life, seasons in our life as Christians, but do we really realize that this could be the very last day we spend on earth? That the trumpet could sound. I mean, you could be gone. Could y'all imagine being in heaven in the morning? Some of y'all excited, and some of you's like, I missed my breakfast. Y'all not, I mean, you just think about being from this life and bam, you're in glory. I want to say hallelujah. Amen. Y'all do know sometimes we got so much scheduled in our life, we ain't even scheduled in time to think about going to heaven. Y'all know that, right? He said, hey, I want to let you know something. You are in the middle of the harvest field. Right where you are. Don't say, well, I'm going to wait till this circumstance or that circumstance, or I'm going to wait for this to get better or that to get better. Y'all do know right where somebody is right where they need Jesus. And he said, look on this harvest. Then I want to go in verse number 36 right quick and just kind of give us a heart for where Jesus is speaking to these disciples. He said, the fourth thing is when you come to verse number 36 and 37, he said, it has been sown. Did you know that God has sown the field around you? I was speaking to someone about a month ago, and God began to work in my heart over this scripture. And it was like, okay, God, wow. He said, and he just asked me a question just real simple. He said, do you realize how many deaf people are in your community? I said, dude, I ain't got a clue. He said, there's deaf people all in your community. Around your church. I'm going, I didn't know that. How many of y'all knew that? He said, there's like deaf community. I said, wow, we're missing it. Oh, we're not. Man, God's planting people around us. As a church, I remember, and I've told this story before, but I remember being a part, I don't know how it happened, it was just like bam, it happened when the apartments, these first apartments were you know, come up, built, all that stuff happened to be in the dedication of that somehow or another. And they were, you know, talking about the guy that the developer said, we're in Greensboro. We had nothing to do with Hudson. Don't even know where Hudson is. We didn't know. We didn't have a clue about anything. They say, how did you pick Hudson? He said, I'm going to be real honest with you. I took a dart and threw it at the map. And it hit on the Pine Mountain Road. He just keeps talking. I'm back there going, I can't wait to get up there, buddy. He said, that's how we picked it. And he keeps on talking and talks about how it developed and all this kind of stuff. And so when I got up there around all these, you know, I mean, they're dignitaries. And I tried to be as dignified as I could be to represent Povey's Chapel. I said, hey, it's good to have y'all. No. I said, I just want to say something before we go any further. I said, I know I'm supposed to pray. I said, but I do need to say something. I said, God directs darts. We pray for people to come in the community. You say it makes it harder to get out the stoplight. I say y'all still going to the stoplight. God has built. There's more people in Povey's Chapel. Whenever I had our homecoming, I was thinking there's more people in Povey's Chapel on that day of homecoming than there was in the whole township when the church started. You got to realize God has set us in the middle of a harvest, and He says it is yours. What are you going to do? What are we going to put forth? How, as a church, are we going to be that light? It happens individually when we recognize, as Jesus is telling His 12 disciples, He said, look, I want to let you know something. This harvest is sown around you, and it is sown right where you are so that you can be the difference that they need, or they are going to perish. I can hear the disciples in the background. They didn't say it out loud. Y'all know how we are. We don't really say it out loud until we get on the telephone with somebody else we want to gossip with. Oh, that was another church. Sorry. It just kind of flashed by. You know why? It's like I can hear the disciples say, yeah, but these are Samaritans. What we got to do with these? It was the first place that they understood that Jesus is salvation for everyone. When I look at this little place of being sown, I see in verse number 36 and 37, these seeds, they are sown and they're waiting on the harvest. They're waiting for someone to come by. Let's think about the seed that is sown for just a minute. When you look at the word seed and you go back to the Word of God, you understand that seed, that the Word itself represents seed. It's the seed of the Word that is planted in our heart. Maybe it happened at a young age. Maybe it happened by a testimony from somebody. Maybe it happened by a song they heard on the radio. Maybe it happened by a video they watched or something they heard on TV, or they was flipping through one day on the TV and Billy Graham comes on and says, hey, you need to be saved. Whatever it was, God put a seed in somebody's life. That seed that He's talking about here in verse number 36 and 37, it began to grow. It can grow by many things. It can grow by testimonies of other believers. Maybe you are the seed. You are the one to help the seed sprout. We're not always the reaper. We're not always the one that's going to bring them that place of being saved. But who knows that we are not that one that's going to bring them that place? Can I just let y'all in on a little something? It's real easy to sow seed. Man, whenever I was a little kid, we sowed seed. How many of you sowed seed when you was little? You just took it out through there. Man, having big old rows. I thought it was the greatest thing in the world at the time. Amen. You go down through there, you're just dropping them in there. I mean, you're just dropping seeds, and somebody behind you, they covering them up. You're just dropping seeds, throwing a little fertilizer in as you go. And you're like, wow, look what I done. It was easy. Hey, I want to tell y'all something. Sowing seed is easy. It's the great. All you got to do. Hey, let's just tell somebody. It may be somebody in your life. They just need to know that you're praying for them. Maybe you need to vocally say, I'm praying for you, or vocally pray with them. It's putting that seed in their life. Because they've got to have that place for the something in their life that the Holy Spirit works with to begin to grow in their life so that they can begin to have faith. And God gives them the faith so that they can be saved. It is that place of building that harvest. And so He said, I want to let you know, the seed has been sown where you are. You do not have to go sow this seed. The reaping. Man, I don't know about y'all, but I love the reaping. Just going out, pulling it off. Now, I'm going to be honest with you. I do not like reaping green beans. I can say y'all don't either, amen? I don't know why. I do not know why the Lord allowed strings to grow on green beans. I was so happy when they come out with some beans that didn't have strings on it. Can I have amen right there? You think about that harvest that is there. It has been sown for a purpose. We are, sometimes we're the waterers of that seed. Sometimes there's weeds gets around that little plant that begins to sprout up and begins to germinate in that little seed that begins to germinate and begins to open that ground up. There's weeds going to come. Satan wants to choke out what God has planted in that seed and in that good ground that God has given. And you know, sometimes we're the one to remove the weeds around somebody's life. You know what Satan will do? Satan will give people all kind of excuses of why they don't believe in Jesus and why they don't come to the house of God. How many of you ever heard some good excuses before? If you take those same excuses and you apply it to the movie house, everybody would laugh. Amen? He said, look, I want to let you know, you are in the field. It has been sown. It has been watered. As a matter of fact, it's at the place in Samaria where the Holy Spirit has breathed upon it. All they are waiting on is somebody to say, you need Jesus. And they say, yes, that is the answer. And they believed on the word, the Bible says in verse number 41. And here's Samaria. They become a great place of salvation and a hub and that sends out people. And people are saved because of these believers that are found down in Samaria. There's some things that are going on. He said, I want you to go out and reap that sown seed. What he's talking about there in verse number 36. When you think about reaping something, that's the place where you have to handle stuff with tender care. How many of you ever dropped a beautiful tomato before and bruised it? Anybody? Anybody ever had to clean up after you dropped one that was just perfect? Sure. And so whenever it comes to that reaping part, it's the place as Christians we want to back off and say, well, maybe they'll get saved in a service somewhere. Maybe I'm just the seed planter and the waterer, and I've just been going out picking some weeds out and just kind of sticking some little bit. I'm praying for you. But I'll tell you what, we all are called to reap. Jesus said it like this. It's real simple. He just kindly told the disciples, they're all excited because the Holy Spirit, because He's resurrected from the dead. They've been with Him for 40 days. They've been eating. They've been celebrating. He's been teaching them the Word. He said, and then He said, I want you to do something. I want you to go out and you make disciples. You be a disciple. You make a disciple. You go out and you baptize them. You train them. You teach them what I did for you. Now you go tell somebody else what is going on in your life so that they can begin to follow. And tell them to tell somebody else. That is that part of reaping. That is that part of leading somebody to know Jesus. Did you know if you know how you got saved, you can lead somebody else to get saved? Don't let Satan steal the reaping from you. I had the opportunity to reap. Thursday, I believe it was Thursday before last. The phone rings. Or somebody sent me a message and said, can you call so-and-so? And I called so-and-so. When I picked up the phone, when this young boy answered the phone on the other end, I'm just going to be honest with you. I could have said one thing. Jesus, he would have felt completely apart. God had been working on him for about 3 weeks, he said. He said, every time I go, I can't even sleep. He said, God's dealing my heart. God is pulling on me. I'm not sure if I die right now, I'll go to heaven. I'm not sure I'm saved. And he continued on in that path. I mean, for like 10 minutes, he just kept telling me, I know that I got to get saved. And I said, man, I want to tell you what. God allowed me to be on the reaping end. All I said was, hey, I could have said and been afraid that maybe, what if I tell him the wrong thing? For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. That ain't too hard to do. I said, man, listen, here's what you got to do. I said, you simply need to pray and ask Jesus to forgive you of your sins and to come in your life. And before we got off the telephone, he was saved. God, allow me to be that part of reaping. He said, I want to let you know something. The harvest, it's out here. Now, somewhere in time, church thinking shifted. I can go back to the 1970s because I can remember in the 1970s. And in the 1970s, what I remember about church is it was a good place to go. People shouted, people cried, people had good experiences. But if you had long hair as a boy, you was put out. If your hair was over your ears, you could not usher. I got real quiet. Can I just tell you? Those things begin to infiltrate the church rather than the gospel of reaching people. Can I tell you something? I had never, ever, ever had a problem in my life after I got saved, knowing how I needed to live. I didn't have to make up my mind I'm not going to cuss today, or at least while I'm at church. The Holy Spirit lives inside of you. He is that power. And he said, look, I want to tell you what I have done to you. I have empowered you not only to be that witness, but be such a witness that you can lead others to know Jesus as personal Lord and Savior. This is kind of the place as Christians where the rubber meets the road. That this is really what it's about. It's not about just making decisions. It's not about just being part of this or part of that or part of the choir or part of a Sunday school class. It's about leading people. It's about touching people's lives. It's about being individual with people, being that reaper of the seed that has been sown. Here he also says, I want to tell you what, in verse number 36, he said, there is a reward. Are you going for the reward? You can be humble. Listen, I'm not talking about here's what Paul said. Paul said, I'm running for the crown. He said, I'm trying to achieve some things in my life. I'm going for the reward that people have come to know Jesus. He said, there's that crown of soul winning, that place that you have invested in people's lives and they've come to know Jesus. And I've been able to help them get to that place where their relationship is right with God. Church, I want to tell you today, listen, we can have all these things I said just a minute ago, but we've got to get back to the place that I am a personal soul winner. I am somebody that is leading somebody to know Jesus. It scares us to death. Amen? It's like, wow, I don't know if I can do that or not, preacher. I've witnessed myself. I've watched this myself. Whenever somebody gets excited about something, they cannot be quiet about it. Y'all ever noticed that before? Have you? I mean, if they're whoever they're pulling for in the race, if they win, when they go to the break table the next morning, they have no problem talking about that race. Are y'all with me? If they have killed a 10-point buck that they have been watching on this deer camera, when they go into work the next day or around their hunting buddies, they say, did you kill anything? No, they're going, you got to see this, man. Right? And they'll hold that head up, make it look bigger, you know, take pictures from different angles. I mean, I caught a bluegill one time. Honestly, it was that big. The way we took a picture, it made it look like it's about that big. You know what? Because it's something that's exciting them. When we are where we need to be and understanding, God, you put me in this field not to fill a space, but because there's a harvest. Because, God, I am here, I am existing, I am saved so that somebody else can get saved, so that somebody else can know Jesus, whether it's my family member that I have waited on, I've tried, I've thought about, and I should have witnessed to, but I've invited them to church, but I've never come to face with them and said, do you know Jesus? He said, disciples, I'm going to tell you something. The harvest is plenteous. And the harvest needs reaping now, not after they are in hell. Friend, I want to tell you, I don't know how many funerals that I've done over the course of time. I started doing, I think my first funeral was probably 25 or a little over 25 years ago. And I've always, there's some that you're always wondering, and you hear people, and they talk about this person, they try to fill in the gaps, they try to grasp for one thing they think might be something they can hold on to, that this person, maybe they knew Jesus. Oh, I want to tell you, we shouldn't wait till they're gone. That harvest field is here. And Jesus said, I put you in the field. And that harvest is all around you. Reap that reward. Be a fruit gatherer. Go out and get the fruit. Because here's what he said in John chapter number 15. He said, I have made you fruitful. He said, and you will bear much more fruit in your life. And he said, for without me you can do nothing. Jesus said, get in, understand where you are, and realize there is a reward. Here's that reward. It's found in Romans 2 and verse number 10. He said, glory, honor, and peace to every man that worketh good. Here's what he said in Psalm 40 and verse number 8. He said, I delight to do thy will, O God. Yea, thy law is within my heart. The Bible says in Luke chapter number 10, Jesus sent out these disciples. He sent out 70 of them, and they come back rejoicing because of those who had given their life, and those, and the fact that devils were subject unto them, that God was working in their life. That is that place. The Bible says there's that rejoicing. He said it in verse number 36 and 37. He said, he that soweth and he that reapeth, they can rejoice together. They understand. Glory to God, the harvest is just part of what we do. I know, church, I'm going to be honest. Can I be honest? We get in here. There's people coming here on Sunday mornings, and you know that they do not know. They're searching. Where's the harvest? Where's the reaping? We're trying to give them the gospel. I don't know about y'all, but I want to see some harvest. There's people that need Jesus. And as a church, that has got to be the place that we return to, having that burden of seeing people to come to know Jesus. We sing because we want people to come to know Jesus. We teach Sunday school because we want people to come to know Jesus. You say, well, what if they don't come to know Jesus in Sunday school? Yeah, but we are teaching people that need to know about Jesus and live for Jesus so that they can lead other people to Jesus and people can come to Jesus. Oh, it's a place we need to understand. We are in the harvest field. The seeds have been sown. There's people today in Caldwell County, there's people in Hudson, North Carolina, there's people all around us that really don't have an understanding of who Jesus is. And guess what? We are that trumpet to blow and say who Jesus is. We're the watchmen. That's what the Word of God says. We're there to watch them. We're there to help them. We're there to sound the alarm to say, hey, you need Jesus in your life. Now, I know we're living in a time of political correctness, and we're living in a time of don't step over lines and all that stuff, but they step over lines all the time. Why do we allow Satan to scare us in our personal life about stepping over a line with a friend or a family member by simply talking to them about eternal things, about knowing Jesus? They're in a harvest field. They're in our place to reap the harvest. God has put us in the field so that they can come to know Jesus. So that people around us can come to know Jesus. So that people can hear about Jesus. Here's what he said, verse number 38. He said, I sent you to reap that whereon no labor was bestowed. He said, look at this. He's talking to the disciples. He said, look, disciples, I want to tell y'all something. I brought you right here to Samaria. He said, I brought you through this way. As he said in verse number 4, I must need to go through Samaria. He said, I brought you here. You don't even have to labor. You don't have to go out door to door trying to convince these people. He said, they have already heard. they have already understood. Somebody have been in Samaria already saying, hey, I want you to know there's a Messiah coming. And when he comes, he's going to teach you everything that there is to know about you. And he is the real Messiah. When she heard what Jesus said, she goes through the village and she said, hey, that Messiah is here. He's told us every single thing. He's here. They come to see this Messiah. As they came to see this Messiah, here's 12 disciples who are saying, wow, I wonder what they got on special today. They were missing the whole intention of why they were there. God had them there on purpose because there were those in the field that were ripe already to harvest. Here's what he says to us. He has sent us. The Bible says it like this. When you go in the book of Isaiah, I love what Isaiah does in Isaiah chapter number 6. He gets in the presence of God. God begins to work in his life. Y'all do know before we can ever, when we are doing stuff, we got to have God working in us. Amen? Not the work of the flesh, not what we, but here's what Isaiah said. Isaiah said, Lord, the Lord said, who am I going to send? What did Isaiah say? Here am I, Lord, send me. Now, he didn't send Isaiah around the world. He didn't send Isaiah to another place. He sent Isaiah right where he was with the word of God for the people of God. And I want to tell you that, hey, listen, that's exactly where we are. Just he said, I want to let you know you're sent right here to reap. You are sent to reap. What if tomorrow we go into our school and say, I've been sent to reap. I'm sent to reap that which God is working on. I'm sent to my job because I'm a reaper. I'm coming today to reap a harvest. God has somebody in my path today that needs to know Jesus. What if in our life it is a family member? I am sent to reap their life. I am sent because they need Jesus. And I am the vessel that God wants to use to reach them and bring them to that place of knowing Him. He said, you're sent. Being sent, what is that? What happens? What is the reward of that? What is the product of being sent? The Bible says, verse number 39 and verse number 40, that they, in these two verses of Scripture, He said, they come to know Jesus. Salvation came to Samaria. Wow. What if those people that we think are hopeless, we think, wow, what if they got saved? What if we had enough faith to say, okay, God, I'm going to that person. And I'm going to present who you are to that person. Whatever happens, happens. But Lord, I'm going. I'm going as the harbinger. I'm going as the one who wants to reap. I think about Poobie's Chapel. I want to tell you something. I believe God has Poobie's Chapel to reach Hudson, North Carolina. I know it's around the world. I know we have missions. Thank God for missions. Y'all know me. I've been here 21 years. I believe in missions. I believe everything about missions that there is to believe, that we need to be spreading the gospel everywhere we can go. But God has given us a mission field. And that is right here. That we reach our town. That we reach our city. So how do you do that? I am a reaper. I am a believer, and God has put me here in my harvest field. I've got to reach my harvest. You can't reach my harvest, and I can't reach your harvest. God has put us here to reach our harvest. It is one person at a time to bring them to know Jesus, to be that blessing, to be that witness, to be that light to them right where they are. That's exactly what happened. God used somebody in Samaria who had just believed in Jesus. She went running through the streets telling everyone that she knew that, hey, he's out here. This Messiah's out here at the well. You know what they did? They went to the well. They went to where Jesus was. You say, yeah, but they ain't going to follow me. How do you know? You ain't even ask them. 80% of the population says, if somebody invited me to church, I would go. Now think about that, because 80%, we just went through a whole thing. It's only if there's 8 people out of the 10 are not in church. Maybe it's because they ain't been invited. Where are we? Wow, we can change our priorities. Jesus said, hey, disciples, boys, it's been going good. We've seen a lot of people get saved. We've been seeing all these things happen, all these miracles take place. He said, but I want to remind you about something. You're in the harvest field. And you are put here to reach this harvest. so now for the next 2 days, guess what's going on? For the next 2 days, they're leading people to Jesus in Samaria. And so it got on so much in Samaria that they were bringing everybody they knew to where Jesus was. That's bringing all these Samaritans. That's going back, getting those miracles taking place in Samaria. Matter of fact, it was so much so that when you get in the book of Acts, just a few years later, there's a great revival taking place in Samaria. Friend, I want to tell you, we never know what God's doing in our harvest. He's just put us in the harvest. He's put us in the field so we can look at the harvest and see where we are and realize God has put us here to reach somebody. To reach that somebody that's in our life. How are we going to know who it is unless we are reaching those around us? Let's pray together. Father, thank you for your word tonight. God, thank you for your reminder in our lives, Lord. God, that we are here for a